opened up an old and dusty drawer. A little rusty piece of steel fell out on the floor. As I went to pick it up, my memory came back strong. It was Daddy's pocket knife he carried for so long. As I held that rusty piece of steel there.
All right, welcome back, everybody. I guess it's going to be the second part of our one of our shows we got up here for LibertyCon. Once again, we're welcomed back by our buddy from Being Libertarian, Chip Slate. We've got the usual suspect, no red coat today. Simon?
I think the red coat has been retired temporarily.
Well, retired is not temporary.
A temporary retirement, why not?
Well, how temporary are we talking?
Oh, I'll probably go and wear it in Strasbourg. Put it on this afternoon, have a quick stroll around the farm.
Let's walk around DC.
No, let's not do that. I think the last time we were here, we left a fairly bad taste in the mouth, if you know what I mean. 1814. Interesting showing.
Well, that was not nearly as dangerous or as devastating as January 6th, but that's an entire conversation to be had somewhere else, because we're going to jump right into it here. We've got the man of the hour joining us, our good buddy Spike Cohen. Spike, welcome back, and thanks for giving us a few minutes of your time, because everybody has had...
You've been overrun.
Yes.
It has been I like to say I wear many hats. All of them are yarmulkes, but I wear many hats at these events, they constantly, I've done, thanks for having me, by the way. I'm happy to be here. Then I'd like to say that, yeah, I've done, I think, 8 things. I've done 5 or 6 panels, did a main stage speech, and then they just had me do the raffle for Freedom Fest. So, excellent. But I'm happy to be here. Thanks for having me.
Well, thank you for having us, because honestly, you know, a big part of us being up here was you coming to Franklin County back in the springtime. Oh, yeah, having you come to Franklin County back in the springtime, and of course, Brian reached out to us, and actually, I guess, what is it, how do you pronounce it, or say it, Chip, 1 degree of Kevin Bacon or whatever?
You know, usually 6 degrees. Yeah, we're 1 degree with this.
You were a big reason that Topher had come here this weekend, and we got to be honest, that was one of the funnest shows we have ever had.
That was a blast. I think the rum had a little bit to do with that. He's very good at
it. Well, it was a leaking glass, actually, had more effects on the problem. I think that was the root cause, was a leaking glass.
Yeah, that would explain it.
That would explain it. I will say, when one of the times I was walking by in between two different things I was doing, seeing Topher here talking with you guys, I almost shed a tear. I'm like, this is what I wanted.
Brought them together.
My Australian friends and my Appalachian friends together. So it was fantastic.
I don't want to call him out, but I got to, because it was one of the funniest moments of the podcast. And can I say what he said? So the minute the show was over, because I think for the last half hour, he was, you know, finding any way, an excuse he could find to come visit us. And because we had mentioned Appalachia about 15 different times, he looks at his, is it stop recording? Does it stop recording? Yeah, we're good. Where the F is Appalachia?
We're just howling.
You're from a different country or something.
It was hysterical. Classic. Timing. And it just, he held such a professional sort of attitude throughout, as if he was, you know, exactly where the whole backyard of Appalachia was. Had no idea.
Didn't even know if it was in America. Yeah,
he thought that could have been, you know, on the bloody moon. It was hysterical.
But he was a professional. Oh, and you're like, yeah, that's Appalachia. Right. This is
it was like he just walked out the backyard of Appalachia.
Of course, Appalachia.
Man, he pulled the wool over everybody's eyes. Now he's exposed. Sorry,
well, two Aussies and a Brit at the same table, and it
was wild.
It's your phone.
There we go. I'm sorry, people. If you can hear, for some reason our wires are crossing, I'm hoping the master will just pull that noise out. It usually does anyway, but just in case it can't. But
it's my fault.
It could be.
Jewish interference.
We got bazookaed.
It's the tunnels. It's the tunnels that I put under.
And I noticed you didn't bring the sunshine up here with you. Well, you might have, but we can't see it in these concrete jungles. The skyscrapers take away the sun.
We don't know what the weather's like outside. We're in the basement. We're in 5B. We are in... I think 200 feet below the...
I'm sure this was a bunker at some point.
And it could still be.
How do you know, Simon?
The Jew tunnel is over this. So
I wonder what's underneath this now.
I'm sure you know. I'm sure you and your MI6 days probably had to escort somebody out of the building.
It was actually more hooking into communication lines.
Oh, okay. That's the story you tell. Well, Spike, how have you been since we, I mean, I obviously we talked to you a couple weeks ago on Spaces and we did release that as a show.
Yes.
We were more talking about this event, but you've been pretty busy since we've seen you last. I guess the biggest thing as far as Appalachia is concerned is your whole deal with Nathan Harmon. I've rather enjoyed the Harmon files. and Simon, I don't know how much you know about this. I know Chip's been keeping up quite a bit with it, but it's this corrupted sheriff in West Virginia.
Yep. And Spike and him
essentially got him out, and he has announced for re-election.
Yeah, so he has. Wow. He has. We first found out about him end of 2022, or towards the end of 22. He was blocking anyone who asked him any questions on social media. If they didn't just go on there and say, "You're the best sheriff ever, Sheriff Harmon," he would block them. And so we find out about that because, you know, you can't, when you're an elected official or a government official, you can't block people on your professional social media. You're not allowed to. Like, that's been affirmed in multiple court decisions. And so I will go on and tell them to comply with the law and that I didn't write the laws, but I'll enforce them and they need to stop resisting and all this. Anyway, so that's how I first found out about him.
And he was pulling that trick.
He was pulling that. And so then that happened. It seemed like he backed off of that for a little bit. And then it turns out, the following January, so this would have been last January, January of 23, his drunken daughter, who routinely gets drunk and commits crimes, Carrie, she got drunk and drove her car way too fast and slammed into someone's property. So Nathan showed up, made sure she wasn't breathalyzed. Turned out he did breathalyze her and it came back way above the legal limit. He told the other officer to scram, the responding sheriff that first came to scram. He took the GPS device that was owned by the county that he had illegally put on her car off and deleted the information that was on it that would have showed that she was at a bar. And then he proceeded to lie about it repeatedly on social media, in interviews, and to investigators. And he ended up being...
It's very Clinton-esque.
Yes.
Oh, Lordy.
Yes.
Oh, he's back.
Here we go.
Back, and he's brought a Rubik's Cube.
You're Mark. Yeah, there you go. Turn that bad boy on.
Look, I was just sort of hanging out around the other side there and thought, you know what? I'm just going to come in here and have a word with you boys. Because listen, I've got a bone to pick now.
Uh-oh.
You said that I was the best interview that you've ever had before, bar none. And that you were going to shut down the podcast so that you'd finish on a high. That's what I heard.
President company included.
No. I think you misconstrued what we said. What we said was that episode 150 for us is coming out, and we had as much fun on your show as we have for any of the rest of. And I think we're going to save it.
I was there. No, I was there. And what I heard was, Topher, we are so glad that we can finally end our program because you were on it, thereby reaching the pinnacle of podcasting.
It does.
My
not get
God,
any better.
If we ever have to have Spike Cohen on. It's going to be a dragging experience that we'll probably save for when we're hungover from Saturday night.
You have a photographic memory. That is impressive.
After blaming it on a hole in the bottom of said glass.
Listen. That glass was emptying so fast, that is the only possible explanation.
Yeah, I think it all went right down to the bottom, down into the tunnels below us.
Yes.
I think Spike had come from earlier.
My particular Jewish tunnels are above us, but there are other Jewish tunnels. The Chabad tunnels are below us. The slightly more reformed Jewish tunnels are above us. But he was arrested and indicted and arrested for lying to investigators and a bunch of different crimes. He then pled guilty to all of them and resigned in disgrace. Then a few weeks later, he said he's running for re-election after going on a TV show and having a disastrous interview where these hosts, who had previously been very fair to him and downright deferred to him, were dressing him down and telling him how dishonest and terrible.
You know what this is a page out of? This is a page out of the Prince Andrew playbook.
Mm.
Go on.
You were so.
Oh, shit.
We all just leaned in.
Yeah, I just thought, I don't know where to go.
He's
with
a mouse up for the size 15. Oh, no. Here we go.
So this really will be the last episode then.
Yeah, that's it.
You're going to end up done. On a list and you're going to end up disappearing.
I'll be
the
in the tower.
The title of this episode is Prince Andrew's Playbook.
At least we've got a clear exit.
Spike Cohen. Prince Andrew's Playbook with Spike Cohen.
Well, I can't express how much anybody for listening to this, go and find the Harmon Files on X or wherever you release them at. It's phenomenally good. It's a really good time. And I know that that's a big part of Appalachia. Every show we try and shout out, you are the power. We try and explain to people, hey, look, go give them a follow. They're doing some really good things in Appalachia. It was, you know, there, not to mention you came to Rocky Mount for a few days, hung out, had a blast. That was huge for our
quite
area.
Literally.
Then the thing in Clarksburg, West Virginia with the homeless thing, you know, that's, so, you know, for anybody out there listening, you know, we support You Are the Power. I give, you know, 30 mm-hmm. bucks a month. And anytime we get a big hookup, I try and, you know, write a check for a couple hundred or something here or there, because Spike's been
that,
really
man.
Good to
thank
us.
You,
and
thank you.
Look, he's the kind of person that's coming to areas and sticking up for people like us. And just him, you know, by associating with us, probably makes him look a little worse, but it makes us look a lot better. So
it's
we have
very
to
be imbalanced.
To look worse.
We probably didn't help his calls any this weekend.
I don't know, Abe. You were impressive.
Everyone was loving you guys. They were coming up to me like, did you see them? I'm like, yeah, I invited them.
You admitted to being friends with us.
It's your fault.
I'm now doing my, you know, very, well, I would say Jewish machinations, but that's, you know, anti-Semitic. I'm doing a religion neutral machinations behind the scene to try to get you to Georgia for the Tbilisi, the Europe conference.
Not Atlanta, Amos.
I know that guy was talking to us.
Georgia,
about.
The country.
Yeah, the director, the Europe director was like, dude, will y'all come to that conference over in Georgia? He was like, man, y'all, he was like, I've been here all weekend, 5 minutes with y'all is best time I've had yet.
Well, I mean, the entire weekend alone, you know, I mean, I don't want to say we stuck out like sore thumbs, but
we did.
We stuck out like sore, and it was a little different because this is more of a kind of a, I would say, a left-leaning libertarian crowd, whereas if we were to go to something like Pork Fest or something, it's a more right-leaning one, and we may potentially fit in better up there, but I don't think we had nearly as much fun because everybody here was so engaged with us. You know, they wanted to ask questions. They wanted to learn, you know, what our thoughts were, you know, because, you know, coming from I enjoyed it so much. Like, I would come here 100 times before just for that simple reason alone. The engagement was ridiculous. Everybody was so polite, had so many great questions. Basically, probably just break the ice to ask, what the hell are y'all doing here? You know, pretty much. But
well, the biggest question was, how in the world is Spike y'all's friend?
That was the biggest question from around the world.
I'm gonna tell you what the thing I appreciate. Thanks for inviting us up here. The thing that I appreciate, man, I talked to a whole lot of people yesterday. Not as many as you did, Spike, but a lot was everybody was friendly.
Oh, yeah.
You know, everybody, I got a few jabs because I was just like Abe Lincoln. I knew that would happen.
Expected.
That
was normal.
Yeah. But, you know, just I was kindly surprised on how many people, young people, are actually engaged in trying to make a movement happen.
Yeah.
I mean, that really blew my mind.
Around the planet.
Yes, around
not
the world.
Not just here. Around the world. There are over, I'm sure this has already been said on the show, but over Students for Liberty is in nearly 110 countries, and they are, I believe, close to 70 of them are being represented here. And so you've got people from every corner of the planet, including Appalachia. And that was my take when I was inviting y'all, when I was talking with, you know, the people of Students for Liberty, and I'm like, listen, you know, you've got people from everywhere. Appalachia's are the foothills of this place.
Exactly.
Like, it's right up the road. And they were sold on it immediately. But I said, now it's not just international, but it's every corner of the country too. I think there's no better place for this to be. And like I said, I'm going to try to get you guys in the Europe one because, you know, there could be they need to see it. You know, a lot of times American culture that's being exported is what we don't want people to see. I want people to see this. I want people.
Be careful what you wish for.
The traveling show.
Well, not you, because they'll think of you when they think British, and I'm okay with that. But when Georgians, when people in the former Soviet, you know, Eastern Bloc are thinking American, I want them to think the four of you.
I talked to
that's
couple,
awesome.
Or three of you might have Spanish.
I'm not sure where they were from, but like,
I'm a loner.
Like, man, we've read all kinds of stuff about, the girl was like, I've always wanted to meet somebody from Appalachia. She's like, I've read stuff about Appalachia,
yeah.
The people there. She's like, I can't believe I'm actually meeting somebody there, from there.
Like you're from Antarctica or something like that, yeah.
Well, an hour down the road and you're in
like
the mountains.
An hour or 2 hours away.
Brian collared it this morning. We were coming up the escalator. Brian was coming down. And we're all in our plaid shirts. He goes, oh, shit, you mean business today, then?
Yeah.
The plaids came out.
No, whilst everyone is suited and booted. I had
people ask me yesterday, is that accent real? Yeah.
Oh, if you're how you talk? Yeah.
Let's the way I talk.
Yeah.
We kind of seem like characters, you know, because.
Well, we were hamming it up as well.
Well, the red coat and the Abraham Lincoln suit were slightly above normal, but this is you. This is like today. I mean, you're all
we're
dressed
gonna
how
take
you normally
the piss.
Dress.
Yeah.
Well, the question is, should the Lincoln costume come out every time, or should we change it up every time we come? Because
he's too much of a spitting image from Lincoln.
It's so good.
I don't have a good answer for that because I could see that becoming the theme, but I could also see you guys coming in like just a completely different setup every time, and it becomes a thing. It's like, what are they going to be wearing?
What are they
going to
do this time?
Now, I think you could get away with doing it in Georgia because if you end up going to that, because. You know, a lot of them, only a few of them were here.
Right.
So they probably be like, oh, wow, look at this.
We've heard about
and
this.
And they probably won't have the same understanding about Lincoln either.
We can think of the other.
What Americans look like.
Watch out.
You in a red coat, you dress like.
I mean, could he pass for Prince Andrew? I don't know.
But yeah, what is Prince Andrew's playbook? We never got to.
Yeah.
It involves Epstein, of course.
Oh, yeah. Well, okay,
oh, yeah.
One. Yeah.
You know,
here we go.
Oh, no.
Yeah, for anybody wondering, this morning as we're trying to get ourselves motivated and get the room cleaned up to get everything packed up, we can't get Simon in any kind of a hurry because he's sitting down watching rugby.
It just happened to come on, mate.
And it's England.
It happened.
And it was England, yeah. I'm being televised here against the Italians, bless them.
I couldn't understand in the least, but I think no less so. You know, I had a couple of friends. One of my buddies works very close by, and other ones, when they were talking about this location, so that's kind of a bad part of town and stuff. I saw nothing of that. So my thought process is, for everybody that says this is kind of a dangerous and shady part of town, I think they're alluding to 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue because it's the most crime-ridden area
in the world.
Den of vipers. I didn't see homeless people, gangbangers. No, I mean, I'm sure it happens, but the streets were very clean. They must be talking about.
Sorry, I didn't recognize 1600. I didn't call it 1600. I didn't recognize that. I call it the Coke House.
Well, because this is a beautiful area, and everybody says DC, and we think to us, man, I wish they could do it in a different area here or there, but this is. It's a good location for people to come in and out, especially international. It makes a lot of sense.
There's a reason that there's a lot of conferences here. I mean, here, Vegas, you know, you'll see them in LA, you'll see them in Atlanta. Like, there's a reason because they got a big airport. In fact, in DC, they got two airports. The good infrastructure to get in and out and all of that, lots of restaurants and things. But we are also in the middle of the center of evil and hell. Yeah, on
Earth. It's a beautifully kept city. I mean, it's so tidy.
And is this conference held here every year, or do they move it?
No, the last one was in Miami.
Okay.
That was amazing. I got to, in between doing stuff, I would run to the beach and swim in the water.
Oh, man. That would be nice. Golly, I can't imagine these guys in Miami.
Appalachia goes to Miami, yeah.
Everybody here knows, being libertarian, and you are the power. Mm-hmm. No matter where I went yesterday, What are you trying to? I was like, look, man, you are the power. Oh yeah. I was like, I don't think people even know their names. They just know the memes,
the brand.
Oh yeah. They know. They definitely know the brands. Yeah.
Well, especially for Chip here, because you know he's done a pretty good job of you know, because I didn't even know what the hell he looked like before we invited him on the show that you came up to. I didn't know if he was like a 62-year-old guy or if he was a 21-year-old kid. And we find, you know, and now this weekend's kind of a big unveiling for him, you know, with the whole mixture, and everybody's going to remember him with the stitches and the black eye, and
like, wow, being libertarian is pretty badass.
You should see the other meme page.
Well, Saturday morning really had the potential to be the start of the Hangover movie. I'm not going to say how or why, but there were three hungover bums trying to figure out where the fourth was, and without a cell phone, it could have turned to one of those deals. So I'm wondering how to fit that into the story of the week.
I'm gonna have to get clearance from my wife probably first.
Well, I hope we promoted y'all's agenda, your agenda, Spike, and didn't hurt it.
Oh no, not at all. Listen, I love you guys. I'm glad that you're here doing it, and it is wild to me because you know I'll talk to people that. You know, that they travel like I do, and they talk about when they went to Australia like I did, when they went to Key West, when they went to Barbados, when they went to Europe, and then I'll mention like I was in Appalachian, they'll go, "You were in Appalachia?
You
and
went
I'm,
there?"
I'm like, "Yeah, yeah, Franklin County, Virginia. Yeah, I was there." And they're like, "What was that like?" And I'm like, "It's like driving 2 hours west of DC. Like, what? I mean, we're talking Virginia. Like, where do you think Appalachia is? Like, it's like going to this, like, yeah, the center of the dark side of the moon or something like that." And
People think of Deliverance. And if you've ever seen the movie, that's what they think of. You know, squeal like a pig, and you know.
Yeah, but a lot of people like that now. So I mean, it's not even like it's not even. Like, that's not the negative it was in the 70s, right? Like, so, no, I mean, listen, I tell people, I mean, when they say, "What was it like?" I said, it was like being around some incredible, really warm and welcoming people, beautiful weather, because obviously the time I was there. Yeah. Sunny days, beautiful mountain views, clear, clean air, not a light on in the, you know, you could... clear skies at night. It was beautiful. It was amazing. I loved every second of it.
Actual cannon fire. I mean, you can't get
actual cannon fire.
And the next time when you come up, we can, you know, do it a little bit different. We'll whip out the Tannerite and we'll really,
yes.
We'll really put some holes in Mother Earth.
I know Topher's very keen to see that and participate, which is actually rather scary.
Well, I was telling him earlier, you know, because we talked to Topher and I guess you met him when you went to Australia.
Yeah.
What an eccentric.
Fun guy.
Just an eccentric fun guy, like I said. He was telling us, because we were like, "You need to come to the mountains. Come hang out with us for a few days, you know." He was like, "Well, you know, if it's about a $3,000 flight, if you can help pay for half of it, I'll pay for the other half," which is very, you know, we would find a way to raise money. We might have to put Amos and Simon in bikinis at a car wash, but we would get the money.
And that would work. That would 100% work.
Oh, I mean, we would be done in an hour tops. Maybe two.
I bet the leopard skin thong one. Just
wait till we start these OnlyFans, guys. I'm really going to see it.
Oh, my God.
But he did say he's coming back to Freedom Fest in July.
In July.
I said, well, you get a flight from Vegas to anywhere in this country super cheap. Yep. So if you wanted to put away a couple of days, we could work something out.
Yeah.
We'll get you back in. I don't know if you're going to Freedom Fest out in Vegas, but if you're going to be in the area after it's said done, y'all want to? We could might do an event in Rocky Mount, get Jake and Ethan to play. We could put 200 people in that pavilion.
We might be able to piggyback off of that, yeah.
Couple speakers, couple bands, you know, couple nights, and after party, we'll go back on the mountain and put Tannerite and Volkswagen Beetles and see where we find the place.
Hey, Bales for the real American experience.
Absolutely, we could make out a hell of a daggone.
You know how many people I've. Yesterday, the Appalachian, I was like, Appalachia.
Yeah, I just corrected you just Brian got when he was done. Yeah.
That's right.
He was like, but I'm going to try to see if you can get over to Appalachia. I was like, Appalachia.
Oh, no.
And they'd be like, I can't say it like that.
Try to say, throw an apple at you.
There you
throw
go.
Throw an apple at you. I'm going to throw an apple at you. But then when you say at ya, that's also kind of a hillbilly dialect right there. That's true. What's at ya mean? It means at you. Throw an apple at you, you know, just...
Oh, so
We tend to ignore syllables.
It's true. They blend together.
I live in South Carolina, so I'm enough of a redneck where that was intuitive to me.
Oh, yeah, the redneck Riviera. I mean, everybody in there... You've probably met 100 of our relatives and never even knew it because everybody and their cousin goes to Myrtle Beach.
Mm-hmm. I'm sure.
It's a place to go.
So
what do we got coming up for you in the future? I heard a rumor last night, so I'm not going to say
Vicious rumor.
I'm not going to say it. Because I want you to announce it how you can. If you can't announce it on this, great. But aside from that, if you want to talk about it, that'd be great.
Wait, I want to hear the rumor.
Well, let's just say it's a debate coming up.
Oh, yes. So we are not quite yet saying that.
Okay.
But I will say this. There is almost certainly going to be a very big debate between me and the object of hate for many of the people listening right now on a subject that is about why you probably hate that person. And tuned for more.
My first thought.
Yeah.
That's
me versus the actual personification of what many of you hate about people that think the opposite of you on this particular subject.
Perfect.
Is very almost certain, but not. We haven't. I will feel much more comfortable when everything has been confirmed. But we are almost 100% there.
We nearly heard it here first.
Yes.
Damn, that was so close to a scoop.
It was.
All I need is a 12-volt battery and some jumper cables. Yes. I guarantee.
It actually is.
You could have gotten
scoop.
Out of me way easier. You could have been like, "Oh, come on!" Like that.
But because we have integrity. We're going to have to sit on it. But, you know, because we were approached about it, they asked us how far we are away from this location.
Yeah.
If we might want to be able to make our way up there. And I sat there, I said, you know, I don't know. Maybe if we could convince our wives, it'd have to be a 36-40 hour kind of
trip. We need legal representation and bail money.
To be there for support. But if it doesn't happen, when you do want to announce it, or if you want to talk about the afterwards, we can at least do a Zoom or something and help you promote it whenever that comes up.
Yeah,
that
yeah.
Is, yeah. I thought that was phenomenal. Yeah. I'm glad that's kind of working out because that's what the country needs.
You can have the scoop when we do.
And it's going to bring, and the good thing about this, it's going to bring, of course, all the libertarians in to pay attention, but you're going to get a ton of liberty-leaning, right, conservative, like the people from our hometown who don't really know much about the liberty world, they're going to get introduced to you. Yeah.
Unhappy conservatives.
Yeah, yep, disenfranchised. I think it's going to be massive.
We'll get a couple happy conservatives, too.
Yeah, very much so.
Smiling conservatives.
So aside from that, we'll hold off on that. Is there anything else coming up here in the near future or the next year you want to talk about?
Well, we're going to be at Freedom Fest in July. You Are the Power is continuing to expand. We have some very big causes we're about to be dropping, involving a lot more of the same of what people have seen, abuse of child protective services, taking, children from families for absolutely no reason, which when you zoom out and look at what they're doing, not just to that family, but to many other families, it suddenly looks like child trafficking, because what's happening is they're taking these children from families for no reason, and very often with doctors and professionals saying there is no sign of abuse here, do not touch this family, and they still take the children and run them through these so-called private but for-profit foster management systems and visitation centers and so forth. And the reason that they do it, it looks like, is because they're not meeting their minimum quotas that are in their contracts with these companies. So they are literally taking children from families because they have to meet quotas on contracts that they've signed with these companies.
So, and
I'll be damned.
One of these days I'll bring this to your attention, but there is an example I'm thinking of where there's been a removal of an individual from society.
Yeah.
He's been jailed. And I think it's been a complete setup because anything the FBI does is bollocks. But the child that was in question was never allowed to be, wasn't allowed to be put on the stand. There was no evidence that was coming forth from the child that happened to be his daughter or cousin. And it's been completely ignored.
Yeah.
So you've already stacked the deck.
Oh, yeah.
And what's happened there is it's criminal.
In international waters, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Y'all are doing great work. And I know not long after you came down in May, you had hit us up and you were down in Gastonia.
Yes.
And I said, you know, Spike came up there and gave us his time. I tried to get them to go, but I know they were super busy still with hay season. Says, well, I'm going to jump in a car and drive down.
Yeah,
and
that was awesome when you came
down.
I'm going
to tell you, like, you know, I went in there and I listened to a lot of those people speak, and every single one of them had nothing but phenomenal things to say about you, and you could tell how hard you had worked to touch their lives, and it was just, I didn't know what to expect. I thought I was in the wrong place at first, but so
like
many
people were saying nice things about me.
Yeah, great. I'm trying to encourage people, look, if you see You Are the Power event or Spike's coming out and speaking in one of these places, you know, taking up for these homeless shelters or taking up for these people disenfranchised, he's going to be somewhere, whether it's a town council meeting or anything, or just a church where we were at that day. Go listen and then listen to the other people because it's inspiring. You know, it really is. And has everything cleared out from that event? Are they doing, is that shelter, have they been left alone now?
The city has backed off of that original threat. They continue to be habitual line steppers that the government there. But for the most part, they have backed off. And have now their focus is on when people that are there have, you know, committed a crime elsewhere, which is really what they should have been focused on from the beginning. Yeah. If someone is trying to, you know, hide out by a church because they committed a crime, okay, yeah, so you arrest them. You don't then tell the church you can't help anyone ever again. You can't feed people. You can't give them a place where they can wash their clothes or shower. And so that's what we were saying. And so, yes, for the most part, that has happened. But there were two other charities, one in Columbia, South Carolina, and then the one in West Virginia in Clarksburg that were the exact same thing, where in the other two cases, they weren't even sheltering. They were literally just going to places that had homeless people and handing out food. And the police were threatening them with jail time for it. We found out about it, and that put an end to it. But, you know, we do so many different types of cases, families being torn apart, people being threatened with basically kidnapping for helping people in need. The government abusing their authority to steal people's property, unjust prosecutions, police brutality cases where the police beat someone up and then wrongfully arrest them to try to cover up what they did, and then refusing to release the body cam footage that shows what happened. We deal with all these cases, and they all have a common thread. And it's that the people in those positions, the government officials, the elected officials, the police, the CPS workers, whatever, the people in those government positions stop respecting us as individual human beings the same way that they would if they weren't in those positions. And so because they're in that position, they go, well, I'm just doing my job. And so they convince themselves that their job is to treat all of us like some kind of petty inconvenience that they can shove aside or do whatever they need to, or some political opportunity or some opponent or whatever, instead of looking at us the same way they would if they weren't in the government, as a human being that needs to be respected as one.
And that's chiseling away. This chiseling away of our individual rights,
yes,
has been going on for decades. And I'm not understanding the motivation behind these organizations that do this. It's evil.
It is. And one thing, I know I've told you this before, Spike, one thing I really appreciate about You Are the Power is that you vet all of your causes.
Yeah.
Because, in today's world, there's always a cause somewhere, and there's a lot of fraud on the internet and just rampant. And so that's one thing that I really appreciate is that you vet your causes thoroughly. So if you put your name, you put You Are the Power on it, then, it's a good cause and something I don't have to worry about.
Yeah. So that's a big part of what we do behind the scenes. In fact, the bulk of what we do behind the scenes is vetting these causes to make sure they're legit. I mean, I'd say, I don't know an exact percentage, but a significant amount of the causes that are brought to our attention turn out to be unmitigated bullshit. Like, mm-hmm. It's not true. Mm-hmm. What they said is not true. Very often they were in the wrong. We get a lot of stuff brought to us. Then we get other stuff brought to us where, yeah, it's true, but we're not going to be able to build a movement around it. We're not going to inspire thousands of people to fight for a guy who was only going 3 miles over the speed limit and got a ticket for going 15, but his dash cam shows it was only 3. Like, yes, and he should fight that in court, and he's in the right, but I can't build a movement around it. I'm not going to inspire thousands of people to angrily contact elected officials about that. I need to have cases of where there's...
Well, it's egregious miscarriages of justice.
Egregious, where people's lives are being ruined over it. And then the next question, the third question that when we're vetting is... do we have the resources in place to be able to do something about it? And thanks to supporters like Billy and maybe some of you that are listening and many others, that increasingly is a question that we don't have to answer. We can just say, yes, we have the resources in place. And we are very thankful for that, because the more that we can get, the more that we can take these causes. We receive literally hundreds of them every year. And we have been taking on dozens of them each year, and we're reaching a point where we're soon going to hopefully be able to take on hundreds every year. And that last part, it relies entirely on receiving the resources that we get, the donations that we get. And it is absolutely incredible to be able to meet the folks who we are helping. Mm-hmm. Last weekend I was in Georgia, and I met the Hernandez family.
Yeah.
And the Hernandez family, real quick version, their newborn daughter, was born with a genetic condition that causes her legs to break, or causes her bones to get small fractures. Over time, it can get worse. The parents didn't know this yet, and she had some swelling in her legs, and I think she was crying. And so they took her to the pediatrician. The pediatrician said, you should take her to the ER so they can do an x-ray. They did an x-ray, but because there was breaking, they had the child abuse physician look at it just to make sure it wasn't abuse. The child abuse physician looked, saw some breaking, and said, yeah, it's probably abuse. I'm going to pass it on to the next person in command and let them.
Here we go.
They looked at it and said, yeah, that's probably abuse. We're going to seize the, both daughters. And then they passed it off to the next person and said, yeah, that's probably abuse. So we're going to charge the mother and not allow the father or mother to live together or talk with each other or see each other. And then they passed it on to the judge and said, yeah, that's probably abuse. So I'm going to ignore the two medical experts who say that this is a result of a genetic condition, and instead listen to the child abuse physician who says they're pretty sure that it is a that it's abuse because, quote, statistically it tends to be abuse. And when that child abuse physician was asked by the one of the parents' attorneys what the source of that statistic was, he said, oh, you can look it up on the internet.
Oh, no way.
A judge.
Wow. I hope this guy's 100% discredited.
he's still working. I mean, that, and this is the problem, is that they do these things. But I got to meet this family because so far, thanks to so many people that heard about this cause and reached out to these officials and said, do the right thing, back off this family, leave them alone. So far, we have already gotten that judge to do a complete 180, and now the children are out of the foster care system. They are with their aunt and uncle. The mother and father can see them separately whenever they want to, and now have full medical control of the kids again, so that they can start getting them the care that they can get. And the judge said, as soon as criminal charges are dropped, I will remove all restrictions, and this will be like it didn't happen.
Was this in Florida?
This was in Georgia.
So this took
state of Georgia. Yeah,
this took how long for this disruption to this family's life?
It took 7 months until we found out about it, and then a couple weeks after we found out about it.
Wow.
For no apparent reason, the judge suddenly did a 180 and said miraculously that the kids should be with their family. And I
just remember a story where, and the hospital was lying about it, trying to cover their own.
Oh, I'm sure. Yeah.
I don't know if it's the same story.
Listen, we're talking about individual rights, and you're establishing them case by case, which I think is bloody marvelous.
Yeah.
But this collectivism, whatever this mentality is behind this bullshit, how can we get down to the root cause of that and just rip its heart out? Because that's what needs to happen.
So that's actually what we're doing with this. You know, if we were only focusing on these causes, one cause at a time, it would be an endless game of whack-a-mole, yeah. Right? And at least, at the very least, we'd be able to help these families, if nothing else.
Right.
You know, it's the guy who, you know, he takes a shell and throws it back into the water and says, well, I at least threw that shell back in, even if I could never get the other ones or whatever. But what we're doing is, when we're doing these causes, we are being consistent at what the root is, which is, again, government officials are not being expected to respect us as individual human beings. It is that basic level of individual human respect is the reason why we don't walk around stomping on people like we would on an ant or something like that, or a roach. It's because we recognize that this is an individual human being who has a certain level of their own autonomy, their boundaries, and their rights, and we're not going to inflict ourselves on them, and we expect that they won't on us. It's that is how we have a civil society.
But well, this
yet we
is
put
the
that expectation aside for government.
This really is the fight we need to fight.
For respect, 100%.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So when we tell that message over and over and over again, not only are we getting people to join us to help these individual cases across the country, but we're also driving home the underlying message. In all things, you need to demand respect. And even if it's from a government official, you need to demand respect. And if enough of us are demanding that we are respected as individuals, this ends up stopping, or at least being greatly reduced.
Yeah. It needs to happen.
Well, it just changes the people's thought process.
Exactly.
And that's what you got to do. If you just help the causes,
helped those causes. Yeah.
Well,
when you
alluded to something, you said it's like an endless game of whack-a-mole. So
yes.
Kind of help us out on this one. And for the people listening, because this seems to be something that's been going on a lot lately. It's like Cuomo in New York during COVID, when the Supreme Court would override a law or override one of his edicts.
And he'd do it
the
anyway.
Next day, he would just change one word in the paragraph, and they'd have to go through the. Is that something we're starting to see more of as a tactic? Even with some of these small localities where somebody might say, okay, well, they beat us on this front, but let's go change just a small little thing here. Now they're back at it again. Is that something we've seen at a local level?
Yeah. I mean, the thing is, very often at the local level, because they're not used to attention, they don't even go through all that. They just do it. They just keep doing it. And what has been powerful about how we get involved is when you have an official who, you know, at the city level, at the county level, or even maybe at the state level, but not the governor or the secretary of state or attorney general. It's like the head of DFACS or something like that. They're not used to this kind of heat. Mm-hmm. And so what will happen is, you know, they're used to maybe one or two people reaching out to them a month about something particular to them. And then suddenly they're getting hundreds of emails and hundreds of voicemails. And possibly text messages if we can find their cell phone number. And also their social media is getting blown up for their agency and for them as individuals. And they're like, oh, wow, people are really mad about this. And if they don't back off then and do the right thing, then we show up to their meetings. And then they realize, oh, wow, people that are local enough to show up to these meetings are upset. Maybe I should be paying attention. And that's why we have a nearly 95% success rate right now.
That's awesome.
Yeah, we got that fight coming at our local.
I'm thinking what we ought to do, you know, off topic for anybody, you know, and I encourage anybody, if you're discovered us this weekend from Liberty Con, you know, if you found us or coming in for the first time, you know, go back to some of our old shows and stuff. We like incorporating the outside world with some of our local stories for a little bit of humor. It's kind of like watching a train wreck in slow motion with our local government. As we talk about it, we want you to get invested in it like a soap opera, like what's going to happen next. But we, you know, we've got a big thing coming up. Our local board of supervisors keep on relancing to the ground. I think the next meeting, we're just going to show up with a cutout of Spike. We're going to have to get you to get that for us, a cutout. We're going to set it beside us. I'm going to go up. I'm going to say, my name's Billy Riddle with the Appalachian Podcast. This is our buddy, Spike Cohen. He can't be here in person, but I'm going to give you all the time you need to look him up and see what he's all about. And I implore you to do the right thing, because next time it's going to be a real version of him, and you all don't want that kind of pressure on you. We're tired of being run over by you, and it's not going to be just him. We're bringing an army of us, farmers, Appalachians. We're going to be here up in your crawl, because you don't get to keep running people into the ground off of your mistakes.
There's been suggestion of mutt spreaders at Buckingham Palace.
They double down and double down instead of just admitting, hey, man, we've really screwed the pooch here. They just keep doubling it down, and they pass it on off to us, and we're tired of it.
Yeah, 110% increase on tax assessments, they can kiss my ass.
Yeah, and they're talking about closing down 3 elementary schools, which we need to do a show on that, which but for different reasons, so that's why we need to have a conversation on it. But
the whole point of shutting down schools is to get government out of education, not to screw over the parents by still making them stay in the school system and putting them in crowded schools and raising your taxes. I probably will regret saying this, but you can actually purchase with a $250 donation, you can purchase a life-size cutout of me on the You Are the Power.
Oh, perfect.
There we go. Perfect. That's what we're going to have.
That makes it easy.
Well,
I'm almost certainly going to regret it.
Well, Spike, we're not going to keep you here forever, because I know you've been super busy this weekend. And we got to get home. Anything? Is there anything else you three wanted to ask or mention before we left and let him get back to it?
Hey, just epic weekends. Mm-hmm. You know, thank you for the invite.
Absolutely.
Your company's always been great.
Oh, of course, man.
You know, we look forward to seeing you again at the next one for sure.
Yes, yes. I like the idea.
Don't run yourself to death. We need you.
I will. That is a constant struggle, but I will definitely do that. Thank you, man.
Absolutely. And thanks again. It's always good to see your energy. I think, you know, the energy you bring to these things really makes it fun. And again, you just like your causes, you know what you're talking about. So it's good to spend time with you.
I appreciate that, Chip. Thanks, man.
We're feeding off you, Spike. We're feeding off you.
Oh, I feel it.
And I think you were probably the most sought after person this weekend. So I do apologize for bringing Emancipation Proclamation and Cornwallis over here to steal some of your thunder. But
no, I loved
hopefully
it.
The thunder just kind of got bigger and
everyone was.
We were. Hey, you are the power. We were trying to expand that as much as we could.
Yeah, and y'all did a phenomenal job, and thank y'all so much for being a part of it, and Chip for coming up here and kind of showing us the ropes and everything. My one suggestion for the next time, I think, for one, Miss Tasha, she's so sweet. Every time she sees us, says hello, talks. I think next go round, we need to bring our wives so they can all go shopping and enjoy themselves and kind of do that kind of deal while we're here making a mockery of ourselves. I think it's going to be mandated by Chip. The next go round, his wife is probably going to mandate he show up. And I think through proxy, all of ours. But if that happens to happen next time, I hope it does. Just, you know, kudos to her, too, for. It's hard. It's really we can appreciate how hard it is to come around and have to talk to so many people and smile and go with you every minute. It takes a really strong person, and she's so sweet about it and so personable with all the people that want to come up and talk to her. She is the most, like, when you think about vice presidential candidates and presidential candidates' spouses and stuff, you think Hillary and the direct opposite. You know what I mean? So kudos to her, and thank y'all so much for being so personable and giving time to everybody here who asked. That's admirable. So.
You're very generous.
Well, thank you. Yes, when I was looking for a wife, opposite of Hillary Clinton was in just about every way.
So we're gonna go ahead and get off here. I guess. I know the question everybody's probably asked you 100 times this weekend, so you don't even have to answer it. All I will tell you is if the pressure is mounting, we can certainly understand why it is from our perspective. And if you decide to do it, we will be in your corner the entire time.
100%.
Anything you need, any help, any events, we'll volunteer and do what we have to do if it comes down to it. So if it happens, you got us. You know where to find us.
Well, that means a lot to me. Thank you, man.
And as far as everybody else is concerned, just want to say a big shout out to Jaden and his mom for coming on the show this weekend. That was great. A great story. To these crazy Aussies, Adrian and Topher, my God. Hopefully we'll get them
brace
on
yourself.
Again at some point. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, Brian and Jenny, all the guys from You Are the Power, Chip being Libertarian, everybody that spoke with us. Students for Liberty, everybody that put this event on. I don't know names. If you know a name and want to shout it, but thank y'all so much for having us here and making this event a really good time.
Well said.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Oh, one more thing.
Spike had somebody in plain clothes following us around, making sure we didn't get too out of hand. I'll bet on it.
Adrian, the Aussie. I think
that's who I think
he's
it was.
Too good looking to want to hang out with us all weekend long. But if you want to be a part of this trip next time, and I know you do, we're going to bring a bigger posse. And to help us, go to patreon.com/getontap. Become a subscriber for just 10 cents a day. I know y'all got the disposable income. It helps. It puts us in places like this to bring people back to our hometown and have a good time. Everybody wins. Thank you, Spike, Chip, Amos, Simon. Till next time.
Love y'all.
I hang in there with a rowdy crowd. Drink too much and I laugh too loud. That's just me. That's how I'll always be. I roll my own every now and then. I love a good buzz with a few close friends. That's just me. That's how I'll always be. Won't hear me back. Most of the time I don't listen to them. That's just me. That's how I'll always be. And I wait at the gates when it's my turn to fly. But I'll still raise hell until the day that I die. That's just me. That's how I'll always be. Still have